tax reform. The proposal boasts massive tax cuts for individuals and businesses.
But what does it all mean for the average worker, and what about for the economy overall?
Well, here to talk about this morning, Omaha's retirement strategist, Darrell Bryant. Darrell's one of the area's leading financial advisors and retirement planners. He also hosts his very own weekly radio show. Good to see you, Darrell. Thanks
for
coming
in. Good to see you guys. Thanks for having
me. Absolutely. We've talked about President Trump's plan in the past, so this tax plan. What does it mean for the average taxpayer, the average consumer out there?
Well, it means a lot of things. First of all, it's going to be simpler. The average person is probably going to save about $1,000 on their taxes every year. This, in light of the fact, or in spite of the fact, that the deductions or the available deductions are going to go away, meaning we're going to be reduced just to mortgage interest, charitable deductions. However, the itemized deductions, or the standard deduction, I should say, is going up to $24,700. So that's going to help a lot of people. So the bottom line there is about $1,000 per year for the average household. Simpler tax brackets, instead of seven tax brackets that we have right now, we'll have three tax brackets at 10, 25, and 35. Mm-hmm. And right now the maximum is 39. So that'll help quite a little bit.
So simplifying the process a little bit.
Definitely simplifying. Yeah. I mean, we could get even simpler than that if you ask me, but I'd like a flat tax, but definitely a step in the right direction.
Yeah. Well, if we're paying less, then that means less is going in. So what does it mean for the economy as a whole?
Well, it depends on who you ask. If you're fiscally conservative, you would say, well, if we're paying less in taxes, then we're going to retain some of our earnings, whether it's corporate earnings or personal. And if we're retaining some of our dollars, well, we have to put it somewhere, right? So for the personally, you're probably going to do either college education funding, you might fund your retirement more properly, or you could spend the money. Well, a lot of us would say, well, if we're spending more money, that's going to create more demand for goods and services. If there's more demand for goods and services, that's going to create jobs. And if that creates jobs, then we have a stronger economy and a stronger stock market as well. So if you believe, as I do, in more of a trickle-down feel, such as the Reagan-esque tax strategy, an economic strategy, then you would think this would be a great move. Or if you're a small business owner and you're going to go from a 35% tax rate to a 15% tax rate, well, and $500,000 in earnings, that's an extra $100,000 laying around during the year. So you can expand, you can hire a couple of people maybe, or more R&D or whatever that might be. So it's a big deal. If we can just reduce taxes, I think we'll see the economy expand.
Now let's focus a little bit on people getting closer to retirement, because I think there's a misconception out there that you don't pay as much in taxes when you retire. Is that true, or how much do you have to think about taxes in retirement?
Well, it's a real big deal. First of all, taxes will remain your number one expense. They're your number one expense now. They're going to be your number one expense when you retire. property taxes, state taxes, federal taxes, taxes on dividends, capital gains, auto tax. I mean, it's a really, really big deal. So when you go into retirement, the notion that your tax rates are going to go down is probably a misconception.
Are people calculating taxes when they put their retirement plan together? I mean,
well, we do.
The average people, I know you
yeah,
do.
Yeah, we do, but most people do not. So one of the things we have to do as soon as people walk in the door, say, what kind of income are we looking for to generate during retirement, and what are the sources? And are we talking about a gross need or the net need? In other words, what are the actual bills that you have? Okay, that's $5,000 a month. Okay, well, that's $60,000 a year, but we're going to need to gross that up, right, to a larger number so that we can have a net income that we desire, right? But that calculation is different depending upon where the income is coming from. You know, capital gains are going to be treated differently than ordinary income and interest and so forth. So,
is there a way to reduce taxes in retirement? I'd imagine that's where you
step
in.
Right, I want to pay less in taxes when I retire.
Sure, a lot of ways. In fact, I made some notes knowing you were going to ask me that question. First thing I would say is consider voting conservatively. For those people who like a low, you know, tax rate, that would be your first maneuver. Consider Roth conversions. Remember that dividends and capital gains are taxed at a different rate than ordinary income, so plan accordingly. Always do tax loss harvesting at the end of every year with your non-IRA accounts. Your non-IRA accounts, every single year, a very simple thing to do that nobody does is look at the accounts that are down in value, make a trade, sell the stuff, throw that in your loss bin, right, and use that at some time. Monitor your AGI, your adjusted gross income. Let's not get up to a point where, gosh, if I'd have just taken $2,000 less this year, I would have been in a different tax bracket, mm-hmm. right? So there are a number of things mm-hmm. that you can do, and Roth conversions would be the very simplest thing mm-hmm. that I could communicate right now, or begin doing Roth, do a Roth 401k as opposed to a traditional 401k.
Yeah, well, there's a lot to think about when you're nearing retirement. That's why you talk to a
sure.
professional. And if you're inching
yep.
closer to retirement, and you've got some questions about how you can reduce your taxes in retirement, and just set up a one-on-one appointment with Darrell's team. He's got a complimentary for the first 10 callers today, 932-2141.
Yep. And you'll walk away with some valuable insight about how to strategically reduce your taxes now and in retirement. As they like to say, a cup of coffee, a conversation, maybe some cookies.
Probably some. Dane's going to bring you warm cookies, whether you want them or not.
And you can see the website right there. You can head to dbryantretirementstrategies.com to learn more. And I think that was an interesting, you talked about the Roth IRA conversions, mm-hmm. right? What does that mean?
Well, most people have traditional IRAs, right?
Yeah.
And so if we convert those to Roths, we're going to have to pay the taxes currently. Let's say you have a 50,
you pay the taxes up front, right?
Pay the taxes now.
Yeah.
And then it's going to grow tax-free from there on out. So if you're 62 years old and you're not going to retire until you're 66, you might say, you know what, let's start converting some of these. Yeah, we're going to have a larger tax bill today. Mm-hmm. But when we get ready to retire, or we are retired, then we can select those accounts that don't trigger a tax bill. Now, since you've already mm-hmm. paid taxes on that, Roth distributions, Mike, are tax-free. Mm-hmm. So now you're setting up your accounts or your income at the end of the year, and you say, well, where are we going to pull the income from? Well, we need another $10,000, but we don't want to go in the next tax bracket, so let's pull from the Roth. So you got to convert to those now.
Yep.
Free advice today.
It is. Darrell, thanks for your time today.
Yeah.
We appreciate it.
Have a great
week. Guests of the morning.